women having really fabulous conversations and sharing. So here again in a room, I know very few of you, but if we could just end our conversation and just put a pause. We won't stop it, but we'll put a pause and hopefully we can continue telling each other these stories that have been some wrapped up in a nice bow and some that are unfinished. So I think that our unfinished stories, our encounters with God, are the hope of the church, right? We know that's Christ and Christ in us. As we are his ambassadors and the tellers of our unfinished story, we share his good news with one another and the world and the people we love and bring hope. So, I've been stopped on occasion. Have you? Stopped by the flashing red and blue lights in the rearview mirror. A costly warning. Been deterred by traffic jams and deterred by illnesses, unexpected. Just 10 days ago, I was in the hospital with an appendectomy that was, as usual, surprising. So delayed. Delayed for me in childhood trauma. I don't know if you've ever seen the TV show Arrested Development. I heard it's supposed to be humorous. Has anyone seen it? Yes. I'm afraid to watch because I think I might recognize a younger version of myself, if not the current version of myself in that show. So disrupted by health crises, unfaithfulness. I can relate to all of those things. So there are letters behind my name that, you know, we could be tempted to identify ourselves with, to define ourselves with. And I feel like with all these D's, it would be D, D, D. Our unstoppable God loves us. He loves us. He loves us so much that he often doesn't hesitate to stop us and pull us over. Because he loves us. He wants us to know ourselves as he knows us. Valued, his precious ones, redeemed, renewed, forgiven. He wants us to know ourselves as he knows us. A strange paradox. Unfair paradox when we are in the middle of situations where he has stopped us. How can it be through that suffering and those detours and disruptions and disappointments that we would know his love for us, that he would reveal our value? A strange paradox. So God tells us in Matthew 6 to consider the sparrows, and later on in Matthew 10, he says, aren't two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside of our Father's care. Zippor is the word for sparrow in Hebrew, and there, I think you mostly know, plain, small, brown, and gray birds. They like to be together, though, and they were certainly abundant in the ancient geography, as I'm sure in some of your homes and backyards and parks, they are certainly abundant as well. Sparrows like to build nests in vineyards and bushes, and as well as in the eaves of homes and other nooks and crannies, and they eat seeds and green buds and small insects and worms. But in biblical times, they were held in contempt and had very little value. And we might even say the same. Oh, sparrows, I'd much rather a blue jay. Or how about a golden finch or a hummingbird? They were held in contempt. They had little worth and were seen to be annoying. And I think sometimes when we have these stops and starts and disruptions, they can be annoying, can't they? But the sparrow to Jesus illustrates his worth, that how much he loves us and values that. He turns it upside down. No, the least, the silliest, the plainest, the most annoying creature is actually the most valued. So that sparrow illustrates our worth to God. So 12 years ago, my life seemed cut short, a quick stop. I was poisoned by a wrongly formulated prescription medicine. So that's how that happened. I took that medicine every day, and for a condition called hypothyroidism, you may be familiar. And so I happily took that pill each morning, and I did so to my demise. It was 10 times the amount, it was 1,000 times the amount of thyroid that I needed in my system. And over 17 days, I took 10 of those pills quite faithfully. So for yet another time in my life, I wondered, what was going on? Why am I so sick? Did I matter? How could I just be wiped out so quickly? Was I cared about? I asked these questions. Did I do something wrong to be so sick, so suddenly, so completely stopped in mid-stride? After 17 days of a small-sized stroking, not TIAs, but small-sized stroking, incredible head pain, 20 pounds loss, severe muscle weakness, five different visits to doctors that ended with each scratching their heads and sending me on my way with prescriptions for Xanax, I ended up in the hospital for 6 days and was discharged with the cringing sorry from the nurses and literally a good luck from the doctor. So I went home and not knowing what to do or how to fix it, but knowing that I was very, very sick. I will tell you that there was this sense of peace around me at all times. There just was. Through my cries out, thank you, Rebecca, for your story, crying out to the Lord what was happening. I went home and my husband was traveling, so just a bit detached, slightly from the situation and myself, but his parents were quite lovely and they were there making sure I was okay and settled in bed and that my two young boys, Tommy and Michael, 6 and 8, were also settled. So that night I was alone and I lay in bed crying out to God for my life. I didn't know what was wrong, but I knew something was terribly wrong. So that night, 8 hours of my life, I'm going to just give you a few glimpses of that and share what I believe God wants me to never forget and for you to know. So during that night, like I said, I cried out and just said, heal me. I mean, the doctors can't help me. No one really knows. My legs are turning as bright blue as can be when I stand. Will you heal me? And so, ladies, I lay there. And oh, by the way, this is about, I guess now 25 days of literally no sleep, because when you have that condition of hyperthyroidism, which is saying it lightly, you don't sleep. So just crying out, Lord, oh, will you heal me? And a hand came down out from the ceiling, a definitive hand with weight on my chest. And he said, you will be healed. was pretty awesome, but also rather regular. It was powerful. And I chose to believe. And so I went about the next hour or so lying there, wondering what was happening and wide awake. And I suddenly felt a sense of sleep come over me. And so I welcomed that sleep after about 25 days of no sleep. It was quite wonderful. And so I continued my prayer and my conversation with the Lord and said, thank you, I'm going to sleep. This is going to be wonderful. What I didn't realize was that that sleep came at a cost of my heart stopping. Mm-hmm. So it was quite wonderful. But it was my body saying, we're done, we're done. In hindsight, we'll pause there. In hindsight, the doctors later said that that's what happens with thyrotoxicosis. Your heart will just stop. It's not an attack. There's no reviving you. It just stops. And so my heart stopped. And I want to describe to you exactly what you've probably read in books and heard before. There was great white light. And there was a sense even better than that of the joy and the peace that I can say those words, but ladies, the experience of his presence and being with him, coming close to him, was just indescribable. So I wish I had better words for you, but it was wonderful. And it was a time of seamless presence of the Lord. Seamless. There was no start or stop. There was conversation and growing joy and brightness and a peace and just a great conversation with the Lord. There was no fear. There was no acknowledgement of the limitations of our bodies. It was wonderful. So in that conversation, which was a very real, true conversation, which I believe is what prayer is all about, having very real, true, honest conversations with the Lord, I said, oh no, what about Tommy and Michael and Gary? Because I had realized that this was my healing, that he had said I would be healed. And I said, it's coming home to you. But in my honesty, I said, whoa, 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 Tommy, Michael, and Gary. And I want you to know that Gary is my husband, and I remind him just often enough that he was the third on the list.
And what's his name?
Yeah, really. That was... So, anyway, I asked that honest question, and my heart just broke inside as it was not even beating in my body, and I came back. I came back. My heart stopped. Started beating, and I realized I was awake, right? But at that moment, I'm telling you this with 12 years experience in between. But at that moment, I knew I was awake, and I experienced a sudden despair. So from having the amazing closeness that I can't even describe to you, from having that hand come down and literally press into my chest and say, you are healed, I came awake to darkness, to no sense of his presence. And I am sure some of you have experienced that in this room, but it was the darkest, most awful time. He wasn't close. He wasn't there. I did not feel him. I did not know him. And I saw in the ceiling clashes and flashes of light, red and green and yellow and clashing sounds. And all I could do in my weakened state was stay there, in my despairing state, stay there and watch this happen and know that there was nothing between me and that. And no sense of God's presence or comfort or care or nothing. So I laid awake, and the hours, the minutes ticked by. It was probably 4 hours. And I looked to my right, and the sun was coming up on the east horizon. And it was such a relief to have the light come into the room. Such a relief. The light filtered and brightened, and I tell you, the words that I heard God say in my mind, clearly and truly and with great presence, was, I don't want you to miss this. Pay attention, Jeanne. I don't want you to miss this. Your days are held in my hands, and no one can separate you from my love. Your days are held in my hands. No one can take those. Psalm 139, 15 and 17, your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. All of them were written. He knows every single one. Joshua, no one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave or forsake you. God stops us because he has something for us. He didn't want me to miss this. I was not subject to Satan's imposter, the imposter of death at that moment. I was not subject to that. God stops us because he has something for us that he doesn't want us to miss. We don't want to miss this. We don't want to miss what he has for us in our sufferings and our losses and our disappointments and our detours. He also didn't want me to miss that. He fights for me, and he fights for us. So in that time of clashing that I could not understand, but it was dark, it was awful, what he revealed to me was that he had pulled back the veil. He pulled back the veil that separates us, separates this world from the heavenly realms. It's thin, ladies, thinner than we realize. He pulled it back and allowed me to see the battle over me, the battle over you and us in this room. It's just behind the veil. He fights for us. He's not a passive God, and he did not want me to miss that. In Exodus 14, it says, the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. For the struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Ephesians 6 says, contend, O Lord, with those who contend with me. Fight against those who fight against me. In Psalm 35, those verses are true, and God is in those, and that living word, Jesus Christ, is for us, and he fights for us, and he died for us. So that when we do die, we'll go right to be with him, right into his arms, nothing to be afraid of, seamless, no stop with our unstoppable God. Just goes right in. And so the third thing we don't want to miss, and he did not want me to miss, was with him we will finish well. Because oftentimes, when God uses that suffering, that trial, whatever its cause, there's a call that comes through it, with it. And we often think of that call, right? And I thought, well, it's a vocational call, perhaps. It's a call to do something. It's a call to learn something. He didn't want to miss. Didn't want me to miss those things. But what it truly is a call to revival. It's a call to revive us into our intimate relationship with him. It's what we're talking about this weekend at GA. It's what Andrew's talking about. It's an invitation to Jesus himself, to revival, to revive our spirits, our lives, our minds, and it's beautiful. An invitation to be aware and examine, to ask questions. Lord, what do you want? And to wait. I know what I want. I wanted to be healed. It took 7 years. What do you want? The tougher questions. He doesn't want us to miss this life he's given us, to be alive in Christ, to be awake and aware, and to be listening. Sparrows, they're also a reference to freedom. And so what I realized in my life, I've seen sparrows, and I'll confess with you, I think, oh, look, my sister, look at her, she's a sparrow. She's a sparrow, she's relying on the Lord. She's of value, she's a sparrow. And what he showed me is, I'm a sparrow. I often look to others, oh, look at the sparrow. So this week or last week when my toes were in the grass and I was kind of laid low and couldn't get anywhere, I realized, oh, I'm the sparrow. I'm the sparrow, we're the sparrow. He loves us, we're of value. He rescues us and saves us and sustains us. And we know this in our heads, but I just want you to know not to miss it in your heart. Don't miss this. So whatever opportunity he gives you, that long obedience in the same direction, don't miss more of him, the invitation he has for you. Ask the tough questions. They're not pat answers. They're uniquely made for each of you. It's a narrow path. Choose it. It's a wonderful joy. Choose it. We have this God. We have each other. Don't miss him. Don't miss it. Don't miss us. And don't miss him. So, a single sparrow on a roof represents sadness, depression, and insignificance. I lay awake and I have become like a bird alone on a roof, Psalm 102:7. We have him. We have each other. Don't miss it. So enjoy the time you get to share at your tables, your stories. God bless you.